First of four straight home games to open the year for Oregon. Gus Mahlzagn, Arkansas State's new head coach. His name was attached to other jobs, but he went back to his home state. He said he wants to make this school the Boise State of the South. There's a guy getting a lot of preseason Heisman hype, DeAnthony Thomas. So dangerous. A sophomore, one of the most dynamic players in all of college football. Oregon won the toss and will receive. Josh Huff also back, as Luke Ferguson will be kicking from the 35-yard line. New rule in college football. And they're going to play some keep away from the dangerous DeAnthony Thomas, as the fair catch was hauled in at the 27 by Deion Jordan, All-America candidate at defensive end. So Marcus Mar-I-o-tah, and that is how you pronounce the name, because mom called from Hawaii, Matt, and said, listen up, folks, it's Mar-I-o-tah. Put a hyphen between that Mario and Tom. Only 18 years old, 6'4", 211. Chip Kelly said, seemingly unflappable. And Kenyon Barner almost breaks that one. And in typical Kenyon Barner fashion, a good spurt through the defensive line and a gain of 18 yards, a tackle by Tawshawn Holmes.
You know, there's one thing about talking about playing against this pace, and then there's another one realizing just how fast it is.
Mar-I-o-tah, quick strike to the near side, and he's able to get it complete to Darrell Hawkins.
So defensively, you have to get your calls in right away. They're at the line of scrimmage, ready to go. These offensive linemen, they run to the ball. They're ready to go when the umpire puts the ball down. Look at that. They're following him.
Pressure comes, and he goes down. That was Shervarius Jackson. A lot of experience, a JUCO transfer, senior, off the edge.
They just do a nice stunt, and he comes back to the inside. They slid his way, and he got past the center, who slid to him.
Nick Nelms also getting involved there. So it makes for a second and 18, backed up just beyond midfield. Line to make is inside the 32. And the inside keep with Kenyon Barner. Spent 3 years backing up LaMichael James. James, Oregon's all-time leading rusher. Second-round draft pick of the 49ers.
One of the things that you do, you know, you're talking about playing about Barner and Mar-I-o-tah and DeAnthony Thomas, and you also are playing against this pace. The best way to take the pace out is get a negative play, which they did.
Mar-I-o-tah over the middle, and he has it complete to Keenan Lowe. Lowe had himself a great fall camp. And it is a first down for the Ducks as they speed up to the line again.
What you can't teach is poise, and that's what he has in the pocket. You mentioned Chip Kelly said he's unflappable. That's an awesome quality for a quarterback.
Mar-I-o-tah with time, and that is complete inside the 10 to DeAnthony Thomas. First and goal, Oregon, just like that.
DeAnthony Thomas can beat you from so many different spots on the field.
Barner driving ahead and in. Well, 2012 looks much the same like last season ended up for the Ducks. Plenty of offense.
Kenyon Barner is a guy that everybody kind of overlooks because of DeAnthony Thomas.
Unbalanced formation, and they snap it. And they score the two-point conversion. And that was Deion Jordan, the star defensive player, on the pass from Jackson Rice. Punter to defensive end for a two-point conversion. The 18-year-old from Honolulu, Marcus Mar-I-o-tah, bringing the Ducks right down the field against Arkansas State. 8-0. Oregon has the most touchdown drives of 2 minutes or fewer since the start of the 2010 season. Minute 38, 7 plays, and Barner caps it with a 4-yard touchdown run. And then they throw off the unbalanced formation for the two-pointer. Alejandro Maldonado kicking off, as he will do so many times this year. David Oku former SEC top recruit, back deep on the return from the two. Here's Oku, and he is wrapped up at the 21-yard line. Oku in the backfield with Applin. And he barely gets back to the line of scrimmage as Kiko Alonzo was there to find him. Defensive MVP of the Rose Bowl.
Gus Mahlzagn was the offensive coordinator for Auburn in that championship game. Doesn't quite have the same personnel here.
Sprints to the near side. Flag is down.
False start. Number 60. Offense. 5-yard penalty. Repeat second down.
So he's very confident coming back to his home state. He was a high school coaching legend. Second and 15 now. Quickly throw it out to Josh Jarboe, who makes the first man miss and just gets a yard past the original line of scrimmage before he was tackled by Alonzo. His offense held without a touchdown in his debut with Washington State. Third and 14. Applin tries to set up the screen. David Oku picks up a block and drives his leg. He's going to be just short of the line to make by a yard. It was Michael Clay and Brian Jackson. Nelly Sullivan to punt. Thomas. And he scoots ahead to the 32. Those are tonight's uniforms. Never been put together this combination before. Freshly revealed with the lightning yellow and apple green. Of course, in recent years, they've become the fashion statement of college football. We like to term it the O collection. Matt, as we take a look at the recent uniform combinations for the Ducks. Remember the Rose Bowl, the chrome helmets? Of course, it got everybody's attention in the national championship game a couple years ago with looked like a highlighter exploded on their shoes and socks. And tonight, no different as they're going with the helmets of lightning yellow and the jerseys of apple green, claiming the shoes as a chrome green combination. Mar-I-o-tah swings it out of the backfield to Kenyon Barner, and Barner is out to the 41-yard line.
Got excellent size, good speed, catches the ball well. He blocks and protects inside. He'll do well at the next level.
Second and two now. Thomas was the man in motion. That is incomplete. The pitch to Thomas. And watch out for the speed here. DeAnthony Thomas, a flag is down as he makes his way across the goal line, but we will check the flag. As Chip Kelly told us, I've never seen anybody like him.
This one looks like it's going to come back, but it was all set up by Mar-I-o-tah.
10-yard penalty, third down.
And you got Darrell Hawkins, the receiver who was trying to seal that edge. Let's look at the athleticism of DeAnthony.
This is just pure speed. And he just hits another gear. Nice run skill through there at the end. But Mar-I-o-tah, right in the beginning, he held it right to the end and then flipped it out. It was great timing by the quarterback.
Negates a 59-yard touchdown run.
First down after the penalty enforcement.
So they mark the penalty and it still gives them the first down. So it is first down and 10. Barner in the backfield with Mar-I-o-tah. And this is Addison.
On the defense,
thanks, Reese.
24. 15-yard penalty. First down.
Out of the gun here on first down. And he gets it to his tight end, Colt Lyerla. And Lyerla, big athlete at 6'5", 246. Returned to the team just a couple of weeks ago, was dealing with personal issues. Coaches knew that he planned to return, so he's playing a bit of catch-up at the end of fall camp and into this first game.
He's a good-looking rascal.
They like him a lot.
Yeah, he catches the ball well. He can block inside. He's got some size to him, and they take advantage of every physical attribute you have up here. I'm so impressed with what Chip Kelly does here.
Barner looking for a hole. Offensive line driving a bit with him, still pushing the pile forward. Depend on the mark. Flag comes in the defensive backfield.
Well, when you take a look at Oregon, you have to choose them. You got Barner, Thomas, Jordan, Boyett. They all can play. They all play with speed. And they're all very, very smart, high football IQs.
Deion Jordan already has a score tonight, the
after
defensive
the play,
end.
Personal foul, defense, number 8. Finley's half the distance to the goal, first down.
But Mar-I-o-tah shows that ability to be unflappable in the face of all situations that we've seen so far that's presented to him. I really liked him in the option game. Nice patience. That stuff's hard to do and he does it well.
Loyola lines up in the backfield. Mar-I-o-tah to the goal line, and that is hauled in for a touchdown. DeAnthony Thomas, every which way he does it. A year ago, he averaged a touchdown every 6.3 touches from scrimmage. Here they go. Let's see if they go with a two-pointer again. Last time, they passed off of that formation. This time, Rob Beard's going to set up for an extra point.
He's just looking at numbers, and if he has a number advantage, he takes advantage of it.
Nothing. Marcus Mar-I-o-tah, 67-yard drive, 12-yard touchdown pass to Dat DeAnthony Thomas.
It depends on your perspective, Tess, you know, because if you're on the other side of that, not a good thing.
See, puddles already being passed around like a beach ball here in the crowd at Autzen as Maldonado to kick off again. Here's David Oku. And he can't even find his way to the 20-yard line. Let's check in with Reese and replace Ryan Broyles. Got the transfer from Penn State in there. And snap was a little off to Applin, and he can't find anywhere to go at all. Applin finds Jackson. Jackson looking for a block, and ball came out at the end there. And it's still loose on the ground, and the Ducks recover it.
Remember I mentioned the lights were too bright for this team. And that's just a nice play right there in the corner. Just gets a nice hit right on the football. That's Dustin Haynes. Oh, no, it's Olomu. Olomu, sorry.
Ekpre Olomu. So the Ducks this time will start at the 22. Barner to the outside. Can he get the edge? Forced out, run down. Mar-I-o-tah to the tight end. Lyerla makes the first man miss, and look at him stay his ground. It'll be first and goal as he pushes the pile just inside the five. Mar-I-o-tah now sprinting to the near side, to the end zone, back of the end zone, touchdown Josh Huff.
Going to his left, so versatile, sees the whole field. Great patience and poise. It's easy to see in three series, Joe. It's easy to see why Chip Kelly said this is our guy.
Remember, Darren Thomas left the program early. Bryan Bennett, many thought it would be his. He looked good a year ago filling in. And there is Bennett, who handled the news of being number two, Chip says, the way he would want any of his players to. He's got that competitive spirit, wants to be the man. But Marcus Mar-I-o-tah is showing why Kelly made the decision. And Beard makes it 22-0. Marcus Mar-I-o-tah finding Josh Huff moments ago, Matt.
Now, if you're sitting at home, you're saying, look, it's Arkansas State. It's clearly not as talented a team. But that's not what's so impressive about the kid. What's so impressive about the kid is the things that he's doing. And this is still under pressure. This is hard to do, to run to your left. He locates the receivers fast. He keeps his poise and he's accurate. Those things are impressive.
Oku from the three, David Oku. Marcus Mar-I-o-tah, first college game. And impressive early from Hawaii. Thus the pronunciation, by the way. It's been said Mar-I-o-tah, Mar-I-o-tah. Mom called the athletic department about a week ago. She said, do me this favor. It's Mario and then Ta. Put it all together, Marcus Mar-I-o-tah. And there's his dad, Toa, who made the trip here to Oregon to see his son make his college debut. He's got a lot to like early.
It's a nice smile he has on his face, and he deserves it.
Applin now out of the gun. And David Oku, and he is taken down at about the 27-yard. Many like Oregon this year to make a run at the national title is because of the defense and all the talent. Gus Mahlzagn said it's a better defense than the one we face in the BCS title game. McKissick, J.D. McKissick. First down for the Red Wolves as they go with the screen here to Josh Jarboe. Remember Josh Jarboe.
67, 15-yard penalty, first down.
Still first down, but backed up with the line to make being the 46. Try to swing it out of the backfield this time. As McKissick rolls his way just past the 30-yard line, and Terrence Mitchell, who had a really good Rose Bowl, comes up with the tackle. Second and 15. And a flag comes down as there was some motion.
Prior to the snap, false start, offense, 85. 5-yard penalty, second down.
With Mahlzagn. Signal in. Audibles at the line. Oku in the backfield with him. And that was through the hands of Anthony Kinsey, the JUCO transfer tight end. But I want to see the results. Tonight he gets the first reveal of that.
Well, he's got some horses up there. And that Jordan, number 96 on the defensive end, that kid, he's a player. He can really go.
Absolute pass rushing freak is number 96. 6'7", 243, built for speed off the edge. Applin going to tuck it and run it, and only able to get out to the 32. Needed to get to the 36.
The clock was stopped. Number 74, helmet came off on the offense. He must remain out for one play.
And a little stay away from DeAnthony Thomas as Marcus Mar-I-o-tah has had himself a night and is ready for more. The freshman quarterback, Matt.
And it's easy to see why Chip Kelly said that this is the guy. He said it was a hunch, a thing of the gut. But what he saw was what his eyes were showing him. He has great poise, can't teach it. He's accurate, hard to teach. He has command of the offense. That is just a confident kid who just stepped in here and took this thing over, and it is running seamlessly.
9 of 10 for over 100 yards already. And Barner unable to spin free, just a gain of 2 that time, tackled by Nathan Harrell, who's been a very consistent player, all-conference pick for Arkansas State.
As you watch Mar-I-o-tah, and you'll see Barner, and you'll see DeAnthony Thomas. Now what this team also does is it rolls in their offensive line. And now this is the second offensive line that's in. They keep them fresh, and they keep the pedal to the metal.
Mar-I-o-tah tucks it now, and he dives ahead. Ball came loose at the end there, and they're saying he was down. Beat out Bryan Bennett for the starting job. There is Bennett.
Who's a good player, just a sophomore.
Could still play a role anywhere on this team. They said could be on special teams, maybe a little wide receiver or running back.
He came down early. He was running routes. he's a good athlete.
8.7 yards per carry. He's number one on the team a year ago. Third and one. And a strong defensive effort that time by Quashawn Lee. And Mar-I-o-tah easily picks up the first down as the Ducks will be in business at the 30-yard line. Andrew Tryon, the cornerback, had to come over.
And he's reading the backer. And you see 54 when he jumped in? That's his key. As soon as he jumped down, he's off to the races. Everyone else is accounted for.
Mar-I-o-tah sets up the screen this time low. And Keenan Lowe able to get it to the 23-yard line before being chopped down by Lee.
You know, one of the players who's playing left tackle in there right now is Hall of Fame Howie Long's son, Kyle Long. What a good-looking rascal he is.
6'7", 311 is number 74. And once again, they go with the screen to low. A little middle screen. But Kyle Long, number 75. What an interesting story on Kyle Long. Howie Long's son was a baseball player at Florida State.
A pitcher. 6'7", 290 pounds on the mound. How would you like that?
No, thank you. Gave up baseball and came to take part in the family business. Put on those pads. Third and two. Once again, Lowe getting plenty of work here. Keenan Lowe muscles ahead for another first down.
These are both offensive lines are more physical than they've been in the past, and what they have become is they've become more lean and physical.
Kenyon Barner with blockers in front. Kenyon Barner, hello end zone. It's a good block by Josh Huff and Braylon Addison. 17-yard touchdown run.
He's taking advantage of those fundamentals we spoke about, Tess. Just they do a great job of assignment football. Everybody gets on who they have to get on, and then these runners are just exceptional.
Flag comes down before the snap.
Offside by contact number 93 on the defense. Penalty is half the distance to the goal.
Line up for the extra point. When you're the Ducks kicker, it's pretty much all you do all day long is line up for extra points. And Beard is now 70 for 70 on PATs in his career. Barner with ease. 2:27 left in the first. And it is 29-0, number 5, Oregon, who many feel perhaps this is the year with the offense they have, you know, all the weaponry, but the talent on defense is superb now. The recruiting in recent years has put a group together with extreme talent, especially the speed off the edge. The question mark was the guy you just saw on the phone, a first-year starting quarterback. No question tonight against Arkansas State for Marcus Mar-I-o-tah. Opu from the one. And good special teams pursuit.
The play clock is not operating. It will be kept on the field by the back judge.
He holds the school record for passing yards in a game, ranked first all time in school history in completions. This is just a different level. Josh Jarboe. Shelley told us the other day, we may be playing the best team in America. Said, looking at them on film, knowing who they have coming back.
Timeout. Arkansas State.
And Gus Malzahn's going to talk things over.
Timeout. 30 seconds. Timeout.
First year at Arkansas State. Replaced Hugh Freeze, who left for Ole Miss. And he has those roots right there in his home state of Arkansas. High school football, he was a legend. Won 3 state titles. University of Arkansas was offensive coordinator there. Also played there as a walk-on receiver. And, of course, now the head coach at Arkansas State. And he really believes that he can connect with the high school coaches around the state, Matt. In fact, he had what he calls the A-State ambush. They hit every school in the state. Wants to give everybody ownership of this program. Our Edward Jones FaceTime profile. And as you see, the resume on Gus Malzahn. A big accomplishment came at Auburn with Cam Newton in that offense, leading them to a national title. As they go with the quick screen to David Opu, and Opu tries to get to that edge.
Gus Malzahn, who of course won the Broyles Award as the top assistant in college football. He knows what his team is. He knows that he's on the front end of it. He knew this was a tough challenge coming into it. He also thought that this was the best Oregon team that he'd seen.
Yeah, and he said, listen, this is not how I want to start my campaign. This is not how I want to try to develop my team. This is one of those checks the athletic department games here. They'd be better suited with a different kind of opponent, but it is what it is. Applin now, as the flag is down, as he is able to dive out to the 26-yard line.
Holding on the defense, number 20, 10-yard penalty, first down.
That's John Boyett. That's a safety for Oregon. He is every bit a football player.
And he is a tapeaholic.
Yep.
And he's a guy who you can't keep. He's a football gym rat. He will be a coach one day.
Had 17 tackles in the Rose Bowl. Literally left his body on the field in the Rose Bowl. I don't know if he was exhausted or knocked out. There's been conflicting reports. But he was laying there while everybody was celebrating on that last play. Sir Gregory Thornton.
Basically what they're doing right now is they're getting 2 receivers and 2 defenders. And they're just working the short passing game, having one receiver block his defender, and then allowing that other receiver trying to beat the lone defender. It's a game of space.
First down here, just past midfield, Josh Jarboe with the completion.
Applin does a nice job of getting rid of the ball quickly, and then it's just, like I mentioned, it's a game of space, one-on-one. Who's going to win? And right now, Oregon's been doing a good job of tackling out in space.
Arkansas State trying to find a bit of rhythm. First down, crossing midfield. Once again, they find some space with Jarboe.
Not trying to take a shot down the field. Just taking exactly what Oregon's giving him with the short stuff underneath.
And Mark gives them a first down there on that. Applin now goes to the other side this time and wrapped up right away is Taylor Stockman. Absolutely dominated by the fifth-ranked team in the country. 29 to nothing. Marcus Mariota with a sensational debut for the Ducks. Hurricane and Tropical Storm Isaac has affected many people, states, and teams, and the Red Cross is in action in the Gulf region and beyond, providing shelter. We want to remind you that you can learn how to help for this disaster and for others. Opu patiently waiting just to sum things up. Applin's had some recent success on this drive, but Marcus Mariota, the redshirt freshman quarterback, has been sensational for Oregon as they've had it every which way against that Arkansas State defense. Applin to the end zone, overthrows the intended target, Jarboe.
Flag.
Flag comes in.
False start. Offense, number 55. Five-yard penalty. Third down.
They're giving you a lot of look at the line of scrimmage. People walking around, so you have to account for everybody.
Ball is up in the air, and it falls incomplete.
What they did, they gave you lots of numbers at the line of scrimmage. There's only five offensive linemen. You have one back, that's six protectors. And then you have to decide who's coming and who's not. Gumbo this time just came around the edge, just ran right past the tackle, and was able to disrupt the play.
And he's able to sneak that right through. 29-3. Typically, you have a family divided in these parts. Maybe it's the Civil War type shirt, Oregon State, Oregon. Do you ever think you'd see an Arkansas State, Oregon family divide there with the shirts?
That is
first meeting between these two schools to kick off. And DeAnthony Thomas and Josh Huff are back deep. And that is why you see the short kickoff that is a live ball that is secured at about the 33-yard line. Marquise Lee. There are some folks, and Robert Woods is obviously one of the best receivers in all of college football, but some folks who think Marquise Lee may end up being the better guy cashing checks on Sundays. B.J. Kelly with the reception. And Lee is one of those guys that stretches the field vertically.
By the way, Marquise Lee almost came here to Oregon during the recruiting process. Could you imagine? Here's Barner here crossing the 50 and a stiff arm for a first down. Could you imagine DeAnthony Thomas and Marquise Lee on the same offense? That would have been the case. They were the same recruiting year, and it was close to happening. Of course, Thomas was a verbal commit to USC who flipped on signing day to Oregon.
Well, they could use another speed guy. Nobody noticed around here.
We're all the same.
They are all so fast. But Tess, the best thing about this team is their unselfishness. Watch them block downfield. Everybody, all assignment perfect. This is good stuff.
Yes, that's the three-man weave, like the basketball drill you see before tip-off. You talked about Oregon being so unselfish and the ball never hitting the ground. You ever seen that before, a pregame football?
And you know what, Tess? I've never seen a team warm up so fast that I did as this Oregon team. You got to be warmed up before you get out here to warm up.
They do everything fast. Mariota completes this, and a quick little move by DeAnthony Thomas.
I like the way they deploy Anthony Thomas. DeAnthony Thomas is all over the place. He lines up in the slot. He lines up out wide. He lines up in the backfield. They motion him. They use him for punts. They use him for kickoffs. Any way to put him in space, it's really smartly done.
Mariota. Look at that decision. You talk about being composed, playing in your first college game. Josh Huff with the reception. He gets there to the defender, knowing the first down's right in front of him, and cool enough to pull off that pass.
Can't teach poise. Mariota has it.
Marcus now to the end zone.
Oh, great throw.
I mean, this is just getting silly. Just silly. DeAnthony Thomas, another touchdown.
Dad should be very happy. Mr. Mariota, let me tell you something. Your son is as accurate as I've ever seen a first-time guy be? That's impressive.
Toa Mar-I-o-tah, who made the trip in from Hawaii, smiling, loving it.
Did a lot of different ways also, Tess. Stayed in the pocket. They've rolled him. He's been in complete control of this offense. It's impressive for his first time out. Look at this.
This was the play before the touchdown.
Let's just stop right here. Okay. Now he just dumps it off back underneath. That's to Huff. And then look at the accuracy on this throw to DeAnthony Thomas. It's well protected. He just lets him climb on top right where it has to be. Right on the button.
DeAnthony Thomas, two touchdown receptions now. Dad in town is going to be a lot of trips coming here in the next few years to see Marcus. Can you imagine the confidence gains by having that be your first half of your college football career? So coming into the season, this was the way most experts talked about Oregon. DeAnthony Thomas is returning. Kenyon Barner, you got to like him. Defense has a lot of talent. But who's this guy that's going to play quarterback? Is it going to be Bryan Bennett or is it going to be Marcus Mar-I-o-tah?
That was the big question. And he's answering it in spades here tonight. And the part that you don't even see is, you know, he's 6'4". He sees the whole field. He's got awesome poise, and he's accurate. I mean, this is a dream come true.
Chip Kelly told us he's as poised as any guy I've been around. Very intelligent football player, Marcus Mar-I-o-tah.
That's right to a spot. Right above the backer. Right in stride. It's impressive.
Only 18 years old. Opens up his career 16 of 17 and three touchdown passes against this completely outgunned and overmatched Arkansas State defense. 36-3, 12:57 to go in the half. Josh Jarboe, and Jarboe is being used plenty early on here.
I mean, there's just too much on the other side of the field.
Applin now rolling. And he was looking for Jarboe again, but could not connect. Third and three. Pumps one way, goes the other, and does come up with the conversion for the first down as Alan Muse has the reception. And he himself had to come over medical hardship. He had a heart condition. It was discovered when he was a freshman. Now a senior, had heart surgery and knew there was a very good chance that he would never play football again. J.D. McKissick.
He's persevered. He loves the game. And he's been productive.
Inside handoff, Oku. College football is going to continue tomorrow and Monday night with Georgia Tech and Virginia Tech. Strong arm, but intercepted. Well off the target. John Boyett. And Boyett trying to get to the outside, and he does, and spins his way before being thrown down.
That's him. Yeah, that kid's a coach in the making. He's always here. He's always watching tape. He's studying things. And remember I mentioned to you earlier, they're not going to give up anything down the field. So the safety's where he has to be. And if there's an errant throw, which there was, over the head of Muse, and then Boyett just takes advantage of it. Where he's supposed to be, and then a nice return.
Mar-I-o-tah back out there. And here comes DeAnthony Thomas. You see in recent years where the defense has ranked. They're hoping to improve on those numbers. And everybody points to the SEC, the six straight national titles, and said, well, look at the defensive fronts. Look at that front seven and how dominant they are compared to other conferences. DeAnthony Thomas, watch out. Spins his way in, and a guy who's getting a lot of preseason Heisman hype is showing you why. People talking about DeAnthony Thomas for the Heisman this year because of how absurd the touches to touchdown number is. Tonight, seven touches of the ball, three touchdowns. He just consistently has these highlight moments. Now, tonight, playing Arkansas State, well, Puddles is going to be doing a lot of push-ups. I mean, they just cannot hang with this level of speed and talent that Thomas possesses.
He is special. I mean, there's no question about it.
Rocky Hayes with the touchback. You listen to the coaches talk about Thomas, and they just say things that they don't say about other players, Matt.
Well,
take a look back.
Yeah, great players always have. You have to account for the great player beating somebody. Here's your blocks inside. This is designed to go this way. They're going to block this. Here's your free defender. They're expecting him to come this way. What happens? He reverses field. So now he's going to be one-on-one with him in the field. You're expecting everyone else to be blocked. And you just watch that. He takes care of him with not even a shake. He just runs right past him.
The thought of DeAnthony Thomas reversing field may be one of the scariest thoughts a defensive coordinator could ever have, and one of the most exciting for a football fan. As Oku struggles to find any ground there.
So what's impressive about that, again, is going back to the unselfishness. Now you're on the back side of the play, and you're a receiver, and you're still keeping your blocks. You're keeping your blocks because you know with a guy like DeAnthony Thomas, he could be coming your way at any time. And as he does reverse field and he comes out the backside, you got your assignment done.
Holding many of the records in school history. But this is such an uphill battle tonight as he throws it to the outside of Derek Keaton. So a look back at the Black Mamba. How about a touchdown reception to get your night going?
And he can beat you in so many different ways and catch from so many different spots in the field. You line him up as a wide receiver, he can beat you there. He's in the slot, he beat you there. Out of the backfield, throw it to him, hand it to him. Punt return, kickoff.
64 yards rushing and a touchdown. 55 receiving and two touchdowns for the guy who has two nicknames, but he's so good he may need a third. They go with Dat, Black Mamba, and maybe this year he'll grab another one. Applin, ball is loose at the 20, and then he just falls on it on third and seven, so they'll be sending out the punt team. Now, remember a year ago, DeAnthony Thomas did it every which way with those 18 touchdowns, receiving, rushing, the kick returns, all-purpose yards, and he was sharing the ball, Matt.
Right.
I mean, this was a team that had, well, Michael James and Kenyon Barner, and of course the freshman of the year. Many down in L.A. were hoping it would be for the Trojans. He was a commitment there. Flip went up to Oregon and has had great success.
And they wanted him to be a corner. And he'd probably be a great corner, but he's phenomenal with the ball in his hands.
Ryan Wilburn now into punt. And to return is Braylon Addison, another young player with a lot of speed for the Ducks. This is going to bounce and settle in. Of course, the Rose Bowl last year is when everybody across the country had their jaw on the ground. DeAnthony Thomas just sprinting past the Wisconsin defense, had a 91-yarder and a 64-yarder, and look at the late drive here. Just coasting in those last 25 yards after that acceleration. Hawkins now, and Hawkins crosses midfield. Darrell Hawkins from Nebraska, 6'4 target for Mar-I-o-tah. And there is Byron Marshall. Yet more top-tier elite talent comes into the program. A true freshman, big recruit. Brother of the star running back at Arizona State, Cameron Marshall. That's off the hands of Hawkins.
And it doesn't get any better because the second group and third group are just as talented and just as fast.
Here's Marshall now in his college debut. And looks like he's going to be just short, depending on that mark. Byron Marshall, who, you know, they always have that guy who's the workhorse running back. Barner now gives way to Marshall. Here's fourth down. Let's see if the freshman can get it, and he does get the edge, so he's able to move the chains. You don't see the punter much, and you don't see field goal attempts much, Matt.
No, you don't. But you do see great runner's patience, and you see good vision out of all these backs. Barner, DeAnthony Thomas, and now this one.
Byron Marshall. Mar-I-o-tah now out of the gun. Looking over his options, launches downfield and gets it complete. And that is B.J. Kelly. First-year player, one of the receivers who redshirted a year ago and has really emerged as a top from that group among the receivers.
Mar-I-o-tah with his eyes downfield.
Mar-I-o-tah looking over his options. He does a little shake and bake and settles down inside the 10. Second and one now as Marshall stays in the backfield with the first-year quarterback Marcus Mar-I-o-tah. And that is incomplete. He was looking for Darryl Hawkins. So it'll be a third and one. There's his dad, Toa, came in from Hawaii. Nothing to be nervous about. You look up at that scoreboard and you see how your son's played in his first college game. He's got the shirt with the Oregon O in the middle of his last name. And the freshman, Marshall, will make it first and knocking on the door of a half a century of hanging a 50 on the scoreboard here with over 8 minutes to go in the half. And Marshall unable to find much room there. Marcus just batted away at the last second. Marshall.
Oh, nice.
And he was wrapped up by Harold, who got a hold of his shoe there. Fourth and goal. They're just running their stuff.
That's what they do.
Marshall, can he fight there? How about that second effort? Byron Marshall in a tug of war down at the goal line. And they are an extra point away from putting a 50 spot up on the board with 7:06 remaining in the half.
That's what you want to see out of a young back. That's what you want to see out of any back. But watch him not stop and watch him keeping his legs going. Look at that. That is really well done. Right through Kyle Coleman, number 12 right there. Just didn't stop. Good finish.
Glad you're with us here for what could be a record night of offense for Oregon. Alongside Matt Mellon and Shelley Smith, I'm Joe Tessitore. 50-3, Oregon over Arkansas State right now. 7:06 remaining. If they kept this pace, Matt, boys in the truck have calculated, if they kept this offensive pace, that Oregon would score 130 points.
Yeah, not nice.
And Rocky Hayes, 7 possessions, 50 points, and the average, they're doing that in a minute 32. Now you're Ryan Applin, senior quarterback, who's had a lot of success. You come out and you're down 47, and it's halfway through the second quarter.
Well, keep in mind, you know, this is his first time out. You learn the most about your team in the first week, and you get better most of the time between the first and second week. Now this is going to be one of those things where, you know, this is the first time they're game tested. It's the first time that they're running it under these conditions. And they're not going to find a more talented team to go against than what they have right here.
Gus Mahlzagn said, he said this on Tuesday, we may be playing the best team in the country. And he wants to say they're the best team in the country. And he may say it at the end of tonight. 50-3. Run a stunt, and he threw it behind his intended target. Addison himself, he's got a lot of speed, very elusive guy, tough to bring down. Played quarterback in high school, returned kicks. He's from Missouri City, Texas. And this is a line drive effort that scoots off to the side and then bounces back across the 50-yard line. And you see how statistically impressive it is. Now Marcus Mariota gives way to Bryan Bennett, who receives a very nice ovation from the crowd. Bennett slings his first pass incomplete. And the reason why the crowd is so supportive of Bennett is because it was well documented that Bennett went in and had a discussion with head coach Chip Kelly, and there were even some reports that Bennett was going to be out of the program and transfer, that, you know, people have gotten to him and say, how can you sit behind Mariota for the remainder of your career? Remember, Bennett's only a sophomore, but he is a team guy, and he went in, and Chip Kelly, they had the discussion as Marshall surges ahead to the 44. And basically he said, hey, I want a guy that's competitive and says, I want to be number one. Exactly. You wouldn't want it otherwise.
If he didn't go in and fight for it, you'd be disappointed. He's a young, talented kid, and you want him to go in there. And you want him to fight for the job.
Third and five now, Bennett. Does he tuck it and run it himself? He does, and he comes up about a yard and a half short of the line to me.
The one thing that I respect about the Bennett kid is it seems like right now in college football, if you don't get your way, you transfer right away.
Right.
And I don't like that. Make a commitment, stick with your commitment.
Whatever happened to being a backup, right? Work your way towards the top. And it is a first down there on the mark. For more on Bryan Bennett, let's check in with Shelley.
Yes, Chip Kelly tell us that, yes, it is a transfer culture. And everybody around Bennett was telling him, transfer, transfer, transfer. But his teammates pulled him aside and said, look, you are one injury away from leading this team. We need you on the sidelines. We need your leadership. And really convinced him that this was a place for him to stay. And that's what he's done.
Shelley, what have you noted tonight in observing the disposition of Bennett and the way he's acted out there on the sidelines with all the success that Mariota has had tonight?
Extremely supportive, and it had to be difficult for him. He led the team out through the tunnel onto this field. Mariota was behind them. It was Bennett who took on that leadership role. He's been very supportive on the sidelines, supporting his teammate.
He gets it complete to Dwayne Stanford.
And that one's on the shoulders right there, Bennett, because he bought some time. Kept his eyes down the field as he slid to his left. Throws a perfect strike.
17-yard completion to Stanford. Young man who we're going to see if he was going to get playing time tonight. But with this score, a lot of guys over there on the sideline are going to be rotated in. So a first down. And now Byron Marshall lowers his pads. There's that last completion by Bennett, Matt.
Yes, he rolls by some time, keeps his eyes down the field, and his main cheerleader, Marcus Mariota.
It's a nice thing to see, the support between these two.
And they're good friends. They came in together, and they're pretty tight.
And that looked like it was almost a lateral as Bennett tried to get a little tricky there.
But just to juxtapose the two, you can see the difference. Now, he's not running with the same people that Mariota did. But there's a difference in just their approach. It's the that poise that we talked about. Not that Bennett doesn't have any. It's just there's just a difference when Mariota's on the field.
And this time it's Bassett. Kenny Bassett with the carry. And that is off to the mark. Take you all the way back to the great Norm Van Brocklin in 47, went 7-3. Dan Fouts, 6-4-1 for a guy who would go on to have such great success in the NFL. Joey Harrington, of course, holds so many records here in Eugene. And Mariota off to a sensational start in what could be a season of contending for the BCS national title throughout. Applin now is going to wing it to the top side there. Applin.
Touchdown.
Nice. Julian Jones sprinting his way for a touchdown, and what a nice job. Drew the defender up and then threw a dart to Jones, who was free to sprint.
See, Applin, once he broke to the right, that defender just hesitated, and Jones got on top of him. And Applin took it to the house. His eyes go back inside. Just the hesitation. The safety doesn't come over the top. And then it's six quick.
Troy Hill with that completion. Ryan Applin,
the student, Matt Barkley. Mark and Lou are here. They'll tell you who their top performers were from the day coming up at halftime. Might be Mar-I-o-tah.
It may be Reese or DeAnthony Thomas with his efforts tonight. And Reese talking up USC a bit there with their performance to get the year started. Of course, everybody looking at November 3rd on the calendar. And here is Marshall again. And he's going to get a good amount of work tonight, Matt. You know, it's a really nice advantage when you have this much time left on the clock. You get this score up on the scoreboard, and you have a young team. We're just getting them, and the experience helps.
Who needs experience? And then not only with the back, but with this offensive line as well. Again, this is the second group that's in there. And so you just give yourself this. Good.
Byron Marshall, flag is down. Little brother of Cameron Marshall at Arizona State.
Holding offense, number 55. 10-yard penalty, second down.
And you got to sit out of play if your helmet comes off now in college football. Bryan Bennett, he's got wheels, and he has a first down. Remember, he played a huge role for the team last year when Darren Thomas went down with injury.
He got flushed out of the pocket and then just kept his eyes up, took what was there. He's a competitive sucker. Loves to play, wants to play.
Marshall losing ground here, reversing field, and he is tripped up. Ayele Ford is in at running back now for the Ducks on second and 20. Ford is a walk-on, but the coaches do have a lot of confidence in him. He's only 5'7", 177 pounds. There's Dustin Haynes, you see signaling in the plays, third-string quarterback. Well, Scott Van Pelt now being put forth on the play call.
Who the heck makes all those cards up?
That guy right there. The offensive wizard, Chip Kelly, likes having fun with it. Bennett. Intercepted.
This ball's a pretty good throw. Off the play action, and the ball's out where it has to be, and that goes right through his hands.
Under a minute to go in the half. Applin going to keep it himself, and he will dive ahead. So the yardage numbers that he's put up. That was a big hit that time. Ball came loose, and that is a live ball. This is Tony Washington.
Looked like Applin may have been hurt on that play, holding his hand.
Yeah, you can see him grabbing his thumb there. Cliff Mitchell, the right guard, also being tended to by the medical staff, and he's now walking off.
It looked like
the receiver here, Jones.
He's caught.
Ball is loose. Ball hits the ground.
Yeah, his knee hit first, though, it looked like.
I think they're going to take a good look at this.
I think they're going to bring that one back.
Well, if they're saying that on the field they're ruling it an interception, then that cannot be the case. At best, they can rule it a fumble.
I don't believe it's a fumble. His knee was down.
But you can see that the ball and the body made contact with the ground there. What do you think, Matt?
I think this one comes back. I think there's the catch. Knees down while he had the ball.
Or is it even a reception at all?
See his knees down.
Does he secure the ball through the act?
He may not. That's a good point.
You
may be right there. Now, if that's the case, that could be.
And they're also probably looking to see is his hand underneath the ball, and then it launches up.
And in that case, it would be an interception.
Remember, they need indisputable video evidence to overturn the call on the field, which is an interception.
After video review, the pass did hit the ground. Therefore, it's an incomplete pass.
So they're saying
on the 32-yard line, 2 yards to go. With the clock operator, please reset the clock to 29 seconds. Correction, it will be third down and less than a yard.
call it a long one. Oku in the backfield here on third and one. And he has blockers in front with the first down. Applin going to take a shot. And Jarboe was the intended target, but he threw it long into the outside. Seeing what some of these reserve defensive players can offer up. Applin's going to tuck and run and slide, and the clock is at 3 seconds as they will use a timeout here. I mean, the scoreboard was crooked right from the beginning. What do you say to your team? Well, they've played pretty decent past couple minutes in this kind of a situation, because this is the hole that they got themselves into.
Well, and it started fast, and it didn't slow down. And Mar-I-OH-tah was hot. DeAnthony Thomas was doing his usual thing. Kenyon Barner added to it. And then, oh, the freshman got involved as well.
Bryan Davis here, 29-yard attempt. And that is no good.
All right, Chip, you said before the game that you expected everything from your young freshman quarterback. In your mind, what'd you get?
I thought he did a really nice job. They brought some pressure on him early. He made some real good decisions with the football. That's what kind of expected of him. That's what we've seen from him since spring ball and same with him during preseason camp here. So.
And defensively, what did you like?
I thought our guys were running to the ball and doing a great job. You know, we got caught on that one deep pass there, but our guys did make a great adjustment at halftime. So.
Great. Thanks, Chip.
All smiles for Chip. Mar-I-OH-tah, 200 yards and three touchdowns. DeAnthony Thomas, three touchdowns.
Got that question mark at quarterback for the Ducks, a first-year guy, never played in a college game, and we're going to hand him the keys to this beautiful revving car here that's going to contend for a title.
Yeah, what did he do? He threw four incompletions. That was about as bad as it got.
That's right.
He completely manhandled and this offense. And he did it a variety of ways. But the biggest way, I mean, he beat you with his arm from the pocket. He beat you with his arm when he rolled out. He threw on the run. He was accurate. But Tessie had great poise. He had great poise. And Coach Chip Kelly said he was unflappable at the beginning of the game. That's exactly what he is. The game's not too big for him. The lights came on, and he was very comfortable with it. That's a great sign for this Oregon team.
You know who was just as calm and cool as he was Chip Kelly talking about him yesterday to us. He knew what he was sitting on here.
Yeah.
He knew all along. We got a glimpse in the spring game, and now the rest of the country is getting a good look at just how talented this young man from Honolulu, Hawaii is, as Arkansas State receives here to start the second half. Andrew Tryon, the defensive back, now as a kick returner, and he is taken down at the 14-yard line that time by Eric Dark.
And the majority of that 228 for Arkansas State came at the end of the third quarter.
End of the first half there.
First half, rather. And they got a little bit of something going. I think it's important for them to continue that right now.
Yeah, I thought they started to have some success and find a rhythm. Josh Jarboe, and Jarboe is taken down at the 21-yard line by Derek Malone. You know, you give him credit because they were in such a hole right from the start. I mean, the scoreboard just got silly. But they did stay composed, did Arkansas State.
The offense of Gus Mahlzagn does work. You just let it get unwrapped a little bit.
Jarboe now taken down at the 20. Shelley, what do you have?
I spoke with Gus Mahlzagn, and he said they embarrassed us. We have to man up right now. He said he told them in the locker room that this could be the defining moment of their season. So we had nothing that we can build on in the second half. We just have to man up and play football. Joe?
Defining moment of their season, and you're staring that 50-10 in the face. Just try to make some small gains, I assume you're saying. As Applin makes a good gain here for a first down. Playing spirited there is the senior Ryan Applin. Unorthodox, but he can make plays. Once he gets into the midst of that Sun Belt Conference, you're going to see these numbers go up. There's a little pump fake.
That's just the way it is.
Gus Mahlzagn has talked about his recruiting efforts as he has blanketed the state of Arkansas and wants to reach out to all the high school coaches. That could have been a live ball there.
Much like Chris Peterson does up at Boise. Had to at the beginning. Nice throw.
That was a good throw there for a first down completion that time to Anthony Kinsey. You know what I noticed watching Boise State the other day, Friday night, outstanding game up at Michigan State. All the guys they lost, six NFL draft choices and the all-time winningest quarterback, Kellen Moore. Now you get the sense that they're a program because you see how the recruiting has paid off and it's increased. They're getting a different kind of kid up there now as Applin. There's an example of Applin just trying to create something as he slingshots its sidearm to Jarvis.
And they more than held their own. They were in that game right to the end. It could have gone either way. I just think that's testament to Chris Peterson. I think he's one of the best coaches in all of football.
In stride here
but they
in the second
it.
Half by Arkansas State. That message by Mahlzagn as Oku spins free. Former Tennessee Vol, so in trouble with the law, but that. Remember, Michael Dyer was supposed to be a part of this effort here at Arkansas State, the former BCS title game star, but he was dismissed from the program a month ago. Applin to the end zone. And overthrown into the outside of Allen. Of course, had that sensational play in the BCS title game, keeping his balance, rolling on top of an Oregon defender, and able to scoot down and put Auburn into position for what would be the game-winning field goal. That was when Gus Mahlzagn was the offensive coordinator for the Tigers, meeting up with Chip Kelly's team. Dyer no longer a part of the program at Arkansas State after transferring in to try to continue on with his college career. In fact, he's enrolled at a Baptist college in Arkansas, not playing football, just going about business as a student for now. Second and 10. Under pressure, throws it away. The pressure came from Jared Eaton. Play clock at 3. Applin looks one way, comes back the other. Oku. And Oku could not get past Terrence Mitchell.
And there was the difference. There's the difference right there. Oku, their best runner. Now, had that been DeAnthony Thomas,
yes,
out in space, one-on-one, the referee would be having his arms in the air right now.
Plant one foot, accelerate in the other direction.
Exactly.
Goodbye. Bryan Davis. And Davis is able to put that through that on the board. Once again, a short kick. And that fair catch came from Koa Kai.
Tess, any way you looked at it, when the first liners were in, Mar-I-o-tah, Barner, Thomas, they were electric. They were unstoppable. It was pedal to the metal. 50 points happened at about a quarter and a half. So this team is primed and ready to go.
A lot of smiles over on the sideline of the guys who have their helmets off, including Barner and Thomas and Mar-I-o-tah. Now, Bryan Bennett is in at quarterback as he hands off to Byron Marshall. I want to ask you this, Matt, because Mar-I-o-tah and Bennett, they were in a battle in the spring, a battle in the fall, but Darren Thomas was the quarterback last year, and I know he led him to a Rose Bowl. There are a lot of people in this area that really question whether or not Darren Thomas, even if he came back, would have won the starting job back.
That would have been a heck of a battle, but I got to tell you, this Mar-I-o-tah kid is so impressive. I mean, Bennett's no slouch, but you could see the difference between the two quarterbacks just in terms of how they run the offense and the poise and the presence that they have.
Braylon Addison with the reception. Sets up a third and 2. And Marshall is able to power his way for a first down. Here's a guy you're going to hear a lot of in the coming years. Number 9, Byron Marshall. Here's play action now for Bennett. Down the middle of the field, and he underthrew the intended target.
Murphy had a chance at it. Decent protection. Now he's going to get some pressure right at the end. Stands in there. Takes the hit. Now watch him come back to the ball. That's the defender did a nice job there.
Second and 10. And here's Marshall, and he reverses field and cuts back. Guy who had such success in the SEC as a coordinator with Urban Meyer. And Bennett able to get this complete past midfield to Eric Dungy. About Mar-I-o-tah, he will possibly be the best quarterback to ever play at Oregon. Now that's a big-time statement coming from a guy who was around such talented players. But for those who have been close to the program and have seen Marcus Mariota develop over the course of the past year, they really believe in him.
Well, let me just tell you one thing. Players know players.
And LaMichael
played with him a year ago.
That ball was almost intercepted as Bennett was slinging it downfield. Sterling Young was trying to get after it. You know, Chip Kelly said, here's what I noticed the kid was good. 8 days into camp last year, said, my offense is tough to learn. 8 days into camp, he had it. He knew it.
The funny part was he was frustrated the first week because he hadn't learned it earlier.
He was
that's amazing.
Mariota was disappointed in himself.
Mm-hmm.
Third and 10 now. They only bring three against Bennett, and they set up the screen. This is Bassett. There is a flag down, so we'll see if this play holds.
Changed last year. They were excited.
Number 74, 10-yard penalty, repeat third down.
So third and 20 after the penalty. And quickly getting it out to Addison, and Addison loses the ball as he scoots to the side. And that will mean that we get a 47-yard attempt from Rob Beard. Now, his career long is from 42. Once again, Oregon is not a team you associate with field goals. Remember what happened last year and losing the last second game to USC. Missed opportunity there.
Short.
Prior to the snap, delay a game, offense. 5-yard penalty, remains fourth down.
Career long of 42. And 52 is asking a lot. So Jackson Rice comes in, talented four-year starter. Was one of three finalists for the Ray Guy Award last season. This is the first punt of the night. Some Hollywood history was made here long ago. Does that look familiar to you, Matt Millen?
Sure does.
Animal House was filmed right here at Oregon.
Food fight!
They filmed it right there. In the Urban Memorial Union Fishbowl dining area, classic.
Yes, what I am now.
I don't want the answer to that. I recall that scene.
A zip. That was awesome.
Bluto with a GPA of 0.0.
Fat, dumb, and stupid. There's no way to go through life, Senator Blutarski.
If you have any more of that shtick, it is highly recommended with 7:25 left in the third at 50-13.
Oh, that was a classic. Leave him alone. He's on a roll.
Ryan Applin and Arkansas State is trying to make the most of things here. Jackson with a first down carry out across to the 33-yard line. Shelly, who's your special guest down there?
Well, it's a guy who's done some damage on this field before, LaMichael James, now at the San Francisco 49ers. LaMichael, what's it like being back as an alum?
You know, it's kind of fun. You know, I just want to come out here and see Marcus and Kenyon and DeAnthony and a couple of my friends. You know, come out here and have fun and, you know, do their thing. And, you know, that's the only thing you can do is have fun in this offense, you know, so I just want to come out and show my support.
Now, you tweeted that you said Marcus could be the greatest Duck quarterback ever. What makes you think that?
You know, he's just very poised. You know, he's a hard worker. I was with him through his, you know, his redshirt year, and I see him every day. And I think either one of those quarterbacks could be the best quarterback here. You know, whoever got the job, I think they'll do a great job. And, you know, Marcus got the job, so, you know, apparently I'm going to roll with him for right now. And, you know, he's a great quarterback, and, you know, I'm excited to see him play.
How good is DeAnthony Thomas? What do you like watching about him?
You know, he's an exciting player. You know, he's a human highlight reel. You know, anytime he gets the ball, you know, he's going to make a couple guys miss, outrun guys. You know, he's really fun to watch. You know, he makes you want to come to the games and pay attention.
Now, I know you're very close with Kenyon Barner. You walked off with him at halftime. What kind of advice have you given him about stepping into these shoes here?
You really just got to take care of your body. You know, you got to be smart. There's going to be guys gunning for you, you know, at all times, hitting you, even when you don't got the ball. I think he told me that somebody did him like that tonight already. So I think, you know, he's ready to step up. You know, he's not just one of those guys that just step behind me. I think, you know, Kenyon could have went to any program in the country and started, and I think he's that good.
Now, I know you were in at halftime. Did you address the team? You talk to the guys?
No, you know, I don't want it to be about me. You know, it's about them. That's the one reason I didn't want to come on the sideline at first, because I want them to go out there and have fun and play. You know, it's not about me. It's about the team.
How far can this team go?
They're good. You know, I think they have probably one of the best defenses I've seen here, you know, and offensively, you know, they're phenomenal. You know, Marcus, DeAnthony, Josh, you know, they have so many different weapons. And Kenya, you know, they just have so many guys that can step in and get the job done. You know, they're going to be exciting, hard to beat.
What's been the biggest difference for you between playing college and in the NFL?
Oh, you know, the speed of the game is so much different. You know, I was telling Kenyon when I was like, man, this is so slow. You know, once you're in the NFL, you know, everybody's fast. You know, everybody's probably the best player on their team. And, you know, it's just so much difference, you know, in the game and the game speed.
Are you feeling missed here at all tonight?
Oh, you know, I don't probably know. You know, they have a lot of good players on the team. I don't think I'm that missed. You know, they picked up right where they left off.
All right. Thanks so much, LaMichael.
Thanks, Shelly. Great to hear from LaMichael James, all-time leading rusher at Oregon. You know, it's interesting as Arkansas State faces a third and two. But when Shelly asked him about, you know, is this the year? You guys could possibly, how far could things go? First thing he referenced was the defense.
Yes.
Becoming a common theme up here when you take a look at what this team offers this year is how talented the first group of defenders that Nick Alioti, the coordinator, has. Alioti in his 21st year here. They're loaded. There's Michael Clay, fine middle linebacker. Now, obviously, top-tier guys have been out of this game for a while, including Deion Jordan, who had a two-point conversion scored their star defensive end to start the night.
What I found interesting was LaMichael James, who himself has great speed. The first thing he noticed at the next level is how fast it is.
Isn't that something? This looks slow to me. Whoever says Oregon looks slow. Ball is loose on the ground on fourth and two. So
when you've hung half a hundred on them at half.
Last six national champs, you know what conference they come from. You also know a common theme, with the exception of Auburn in 2010, which belied the conventional wisdom of how you put together a title-winning team, and that is with defense in the SEC. And as Oregon is back to business with Ayali Ford.
They all have pass rushers across the board. They're big down the middle.
The front seven,
yes.
Stout, athletic, physical. They can get after it, and it's not just four guys, it's eight guys up there that you can rotate into that front four.
And it's a lot like what we're seeing out of Oregon. Now, Oregon's not quite as big as what you're seeing in the SEC, but they're getting, I mean, they can run, and they have the speed on the outside. They just don't have the big tanks in the middle.
And here on third and two, that is Ford coming up short as he's tackled by Nathan Harrell. So it begs the question, as much as we've lauded the talent, especially that guy right there, Deion Jordan, of Oregon defensively this year, have they upgraded defensively enough where you consider them a legitimate national title contender capable of stopping the streak of the SEC?
Yeah, well, I think they're built for the Pac-12. But I do believe that for a game like we get to a championship game, yeah, they can hang. They not only will they hang, they'll be able to play with them step for step.
Remember, Mahlzagn was the offensive coordinator for Auburn. Oku now, and he has first down yardage. 50-13, and Arkansas State just wants to try to close into that gap and finish up things strong. Good blocking in front for Oku. Which three schools are the only to play in four straight BCS bowl games? Second and one. First down and inside the 10 goes Frankie Jackson. Three schools playing four straight BCS bowl games. Of course, Oregon's been on a great run of BCS success. Miami, Ohio State, and the USC team from 06 to 09. Now Oregon's had Rose Bowl, BCS title, and Rose Bowl. Josh Jarboe dives his way across the goal line.
The receiver now is going to have a one-on-one, and he has to win. He comes back inside. That's pretty well
and
done.
Jarboe has to do his job, and he did. Little pride for Arkansas State showing it off here. Kenby, they were in a hole so early. And once again, constantly kicking short to stay away from breakaway speed of Oregon. That's Pharaoh Brown, the reserve tight end with the fair catch. Bennett still in at quarterback. And a flag comes down as Byron Marshall is getting a lot of work here.
Offense, number 63, 10-yard penalty, first down.
There's foul right there. And like you and I said all week, every team needs a Farrow.
Well, they got their 6'6 freshman. He said it was a bit of a surprise of camp. They liked the way he developed. And right next to him is big number 74, who goes 6'7", 3'11", and has a famous dad.
And a nice mean streak, too. And
Howie Long's son, Kyle.
He's just figuring this stuff out. He's an athletic kid, man.
Look at Bryan Bennett work his way. Let me ask you this about Kyle Long, because he's taken a very strange route to play the offensive line at Oregon. He was a baseball player.
Yes.
He gave that up at Florida State, comes here, listed as a senior. So this is it. This is his year of eligibility. Is he a pro prospect?
Oh, yeah. Athletically, there is no question. All he lacks is experience. That's the first thing. He's appealed to the NCAA to try to get a year back. And so there's a possibility there with that.
But if you've had that job for years, if you're assessing him, you feel comfortable taking a shot at him? A baseball player comes to football for a year of eligibility at Oregon, and then?
Well, he does some things you can't teach. He has great hips, not good, great. He's got great feet.
What do you mean, Matt, as an evaluator? And I hear that from you and other guys often. But for the layman out there, when you say he's got great hips, what exactly does that mean?
The nice little mean streak on top of it.
Like that.
Yeah, well, here's what he's not a waist bender. He bends at the knees. And what he can do is, if somebody kind of gets the better of him, he can reset himself and sink down again. And so those guys are rare people. Plus, he's got very good hands. He's got quick hands. He's strong. He's got nice length. At 6'7", he's a smart kid. He's just figuring the game out.
There's a completion that time to Rahsaan Vaughn. Puddles is stretching because he's been doing a lot of push-ups. 50-20, Oregon. First Saturday of the season of college football. Some of the headlines that everybody will be reading tomorrow, of course, them starting State College with everybody's attention. Talk about that in a moment. Bryan Bennett slings it cross field, and that is incomplete. Bennett on 2nd and 10, and he's going to try to block for Marshall here. Marshall crossing midfield, a stiff arm, and Marshall gets to the 46.
And what we talked about before about the SEC and the defense. Yeah, they showed itself this afternoon. They were just dominant.
Lee Corso and the Boston Red Sox being signaled in here. Chip Kelly, of course, a New England native, has some of his buddies in town visiting this week.
See, you saw the Whalers.
Well, I covered the Hartford Whalers.
I saw the Burger King.
Yeah, that's the way your mind works. Please. You know what he did this summer? Ran with the Bulls over in Pamplona. With Scott Frost, the assistant coach. He actually said, yes, this happened. We ran.
Terry that was Francona back in July. Terry Francona made an appearance right there.
Yeah.
This kid Marshall, he's going to be pretty good.
How did you like when Chip was describing running with the Bulls with us? And he said, I scouted the whole thing. It was like doing game film. I knew where I needed to be, how to get out of the way.
He says, everybody's dressed in white with a red sash. And he said, I get to the stadium at the end, and I'm looking around, and here's some guy with a bright green Tim Tebow shirt on.
He said, everybody white red sash Tebow jersey. The ubiquitous Tebow jersey.
He said, I know he's big, but I didn't think he was that big.
Bennett with a lot of time, and then he tucks it and just gains a couple of yards. So we're sitting there with Chip Kelly yesterday, and I always find this interesting. Chip can have a conversation on any subject matter there is, including yesterday at one point, ranking World War II films.
Nicely done, too, I might add.
Which he went with Bridge Over River Kwai.
Yes.
Among his
Guns
choices.
Of Navarone didn't make it.
Gets out of the way of the rush and then quickly swings it. And this will go for a first down to Ben Butterfield. And, you know, keep in mind, it's only his fourth season. You know about the national title appearance. How about this? He has had more BCS Bowl appearances than he has had conference losses. He's been to three. He's only had two on the other side. That's a touchdown for the Ducks. That's a great point you make, Matt, because he says all the time, I need the guy that fits what I do.
Oh, Puddles is getting a workout. You knew this one was coming. Number five, Oregon. 11:36 to go. Just having scored again, 57-20. Rose Bowl champs from last season, starting the year number five. Seven top 10 AP finishes since 2000. This is Rocky Hayes. Hey, Mellon, that's the Hayward Field, the centerpiece of Tracktown, USA. You know, they got such a grand history with track and field here at Oregon. Some say the world's most famous track and field venue, named for Coach Bill Hayward. He was the coach from 1904 to 47. There's three. I wonder what DeAnthony Thomas would be like if he just fully committed to being a track guy. Would he be one of those world-class speed, you know, just short of Usain Bolt kind of guys? Arkansas State here in the second half has, you know, tried to stay the course and just accomplish small tasks here. There's another guy that was so fast coming out of East Carolina. There was a dart right there to the chest of Josh Jarboe.
And this game will have helped them.
There's Jackson. Applin threw it behind his target that time, Kendrick Murray, but he was able to hold on. Carter Blackburn and Rod Gilmore will have the call of that game. See what Teddy Bridgewater, the sophomore quarterback for Louisville, looks like tomorrow. I was surprised to see Louisville.
I think there's going to be a couple teams that get looked at a little bit differently. That Michigan team is going to be looked at a little differently. That wasn't a number 18.
Matt, what did you say to me? We're getting this discussion in a moment. There's a great touchdown catch by Carlos McCants. What a strong effort by McCants, and give credit to Applin at McCants.
Nicely done as he's thrown on the run. Like we said, he uses his legs to buy a lot of time.
The team we're going to find out the most about one way or the other is Michigan. Found out a lot tonight.
And that was one of the distinct possibilities that could happen, because he knew that Alabama is strong.
Chip Kelly right now is looking up at the Jumbotron watching a ridiculously funny video that includes Puddles the Duck, which is being featured on YouTube this week. That's how you know what the score is. It's 57-27 as Kelly is. He doesn't want to laugh right now, but crowd got a kick out of that one. As this is fielded at the 29. What about the Black Mamba tonight, DeAnthony Thomas, Matt Millen?
Well, we talked about his versatility and how they get him in space. This is him in the slot, just getting downfield as a receiver. This is as a runner, across the ball. Now, here's what he does so well. He's got the vision, and then you give him a guy, he'll make a miss. And then the rest is just world-class speed to the end zone. And those are just two of the ways that my buddy Barrett Brooks was able to pick out. And there are a lot more. This kid, you will see a lot of DeAnthony Thomas getting in space, and this offense scheming him to get in that particular space that he can take advantage of.
Barrett Brooks, your guru, who looks out for those sort of things down the picture. Because I know in the past week, if you follow the sport closely enough, you even heard it on game day today, he's kind of the cool it pick, the trendy pick of guys saying who they like for the Heisman. Kind of the out there X-factor pick.
That's bad. That's here, a kiss of death.
Well, Matt Barkley's the guy with all the pressure. It's Barkley's exactly. Heisman to lose, and obviously he got off to a good start today. Here's your second and eight here, as Bryan Bennett's been getting a lot of good time here in the second half, and he gets this complete to Dwayne Stafford. The big story on DeAnthony Thomas when it comes to the Heisman is he can go about his campaign the unconventional way. He doesn't have to have the typical running back stats or receiver stats. He just needs the big plays, the highlights, the magical moments. And when he has the showdown on November 3rd against Matt Barkley, a lot of people think it's going to be all on the line there. Both teams could possibly be undefeated. Both these superstars could be crossing paths. It's going to be interesting to watch these two in the Pac-12.
You know, interestingly, he may not have great numbers.
That's right.
He's going to look at his Heisman numbers and he's going to say, yeah, they're not that great. And meanwhile, he'll be getting it in games.
The
like
touchdowns
fifth.
Will be, though.
Touchdowns will be up.
Right, but he doesn't touch the ball enough.
So even you look at him, you know, in like a game tonight, he's got 64 yards rushing, and he could have had 264.
Exactly. But listen, so Kenyon Barner is the featured back. This is a guy who plays in the backfield, plays in the slot, returns punts, returns kicks. And that's what gives him the unique opportunity,
right?
Because
he can have the big impactful play that makes all the highlights. He's not going to be a workhorse like a Le'Veon Bell or a Marcus Lattimore. He's going to be the impact guy.
Who, incidentally, those two guys were awesome this weekend.
Weren't they?
How good was it to see Le'Veon Bell last night just turned on a sterling performance. When he had to be the man, he was the man. And how good was it to see Marcus Lattimore back?
Coming off the ACL. Others battling for a wild card position. And this is Frankie Jackson. Trailing by 30 with 6.5 minutes to go. And this is going to sound odd. This is not a 30-point game.
No, not even close.
This could have been any score that Chip Kelly in Oregon wanted to make the scoreboard read. Now sprinting down Malzano, you see there went with David Oku, the transfer from Tennessee, who was a big recruit in the SEC a few years back. Frankie Jackson now coming to the near side and trying to catch a block was Frankie Jackson.
Good play callers, they try to get you in something. Once they know that you're in it, they exploit it.
Legal substitution on the defense, 12 players on the field. That's a 5-yard penalty. Still first down.
There they are. Two guys a couple years ago. They were battling for the national title. Mahlzagn on the left with Auburn. Oh, so funny that those two offenses that year, and you get a 22-19 field goal to turtle game at the end, and really the offense is that
number one pickup in Detroit. Yeah.
And this is Applin. Unfortunately, she had to listen to the two of us broadcast a game in which Mike Leach was unable to have his offense score a touchdown. As Jackson gets inside the 1-yard line, that's where they're marking him down.
You learn a lot about your team in week one.